Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Huawei's global headquarters in Shenzhen in southern China. My name is Joe Kelly, and it's my great honor to be the host and MC of today's very important discussion. Since the Nobel Prize for Economics was established more than 120 years ago, there have been 51, only 51 awards. Today, I'm delighted that the most recent recipient, Professor Banerjee, is with us today. Professor Banerjee's award, which he shares with his wife, Professor Esther Duflo, and also a colleague from Harvard, Michael Kramer, was for work in experimental economics into the eradication of poverty. Important work. So please put your hands together and welcome Professor Banerjee to our headquarters at Huawei.
Thank you.
Also joining us today is maybe a more familiar face in Huawei, Professor Huang Weiwei, a professor from Renmin University in Beijing, an advisor to Huawei, and also a fairly prolific author on Huawei. And his book is available, as indeed is Professor Banerjee's, for all of us to learn more about their work and their activities. So please put together and welcome Professor Huang to the stage. But let me start today's conversation, if I may, by asking Professor Banerjee. Nobel Prize is a pretty huge achievement by anybody's standards. How has your life changed since, I think it was November when the award was announced? And maybe more importantly, how is it impacting your work?
Life, well, at least in India, I get asked for selfies every 20 seconds if I'm in a public space. So I think the number of people who have been photographed with me is getting into the thousands. So that's part of it. It's a little bit scary because, you know, I don't know that what would people do with all these photographs. There's like so many of them, and they're all apparently on social media. So it's creating its own life, and so it's a bit strange. And otherwise, to be honest, I think in terms of work, I hope two things will happen. One, I hope that I think in a sense, this prize especially was very much not just for us, but for an entire social movement within economics of people doing careful evaluations of policies, not just, you know, saying what they think, but being evidence-based and careful and mindful of the various possible slip-ups which happen when we are too assertive. So being more modest, being more thoughtful about the source of the evidence, being more mindful of the nuances of the way the world works. So that's a whole group of people. It's a group of people who are part of, a lot of them are part of the organization that we started now 17 years ago. It's called the Abdul Latif Jamil Poverty Action Lab, or JPAL, and it exists all in essentially every continent except Antarctica. So it has it's a relatively, and we have 400 professors associated with it at the world's leading university. So I think this was a prize for all of them, and I hope what this will do is, in a sense, just expand the set of options available to all of us, not just to me. In a sense, I can't do much more. I don't have any time to do any more work than I already do. But I think there's lots of people with lots of talent in our ecosystem. And I think, I learned at lunch, Huawei is committed to a kind of open research environment. We have very much the same, which is that we build on each other. We are put as much of our material in the public domain. And so the idea is to just make that ecosystem even more vibrant. I hope that's what the prize will do, is just do that, bring a lot more people into it, get a lot more people interested in what we do, and just open more lines of communication.
You're now in China. I have a feeling you might have more selfie requests before you leave. Professor Huang, your most recent book is called Built on Value. Mm. Do you think that businesses are still driven by profit or other focuses than value?
企业模式都是价值，但是是不同的。 Okay.
Thank you, thank you. Professor Banerjee, I've read and enjoyed your book. It makes an interesting point. And the point is that there are sufficient resources in the world today to allow society to eradicate poverty. Do those with the greatest wealth have to give some of it away to address poverty?
I guess give some of it away. I think the first order...
Is it about wealth redistribution?
In part, yes. I think it's... I think, in a sense, I feel that the concentration of wealth in the world is now so extreme that many of the people... I did some back-of-the-envelope calculation for Mark Zuckerberg just out of... maybe pettiness, and I he spends $10,000 a day, his wealth would keep going up. You know, it's very hard to have time to spend as much money as he has. So it's like, in some ways, I think that the idea that, you know, we are really depriving him of something very important by taking away his wealth seems largely, little bit of a fantasy. I think he gets very little use from his wealth. In fact, it's just, and so in that sense, I think that the fact that we're going to we need to redistribute wealth, it seems that seems to me a no-brainer. The question is more how does one do it well? How does it do it without creating all kinds of distortions? That's the interesting question. I think the fact that the wealth is so concentrated that, you know, it's when we say that, you know, that it's possible to eliminate extreme poverty, we literally mean that, you know, it takes actually very little of that wealth to eliminate extreme poverty, because extreme poverty is, you know, the poorest people in the world are so poor that, you know, one day of Mark Zuckerberg's earnings will take care of a bunch of them. And I think that general fact means that we're really not talking about, you know, we don't need to have extreme outcomes, which we may have, you know, other reasons to support, to just get to this outcome. It seems fairly straightforward to get there. And the reason we are failing in part is because I think we are too intimidated by the idea that, you know, if you start redistributing wealth, maybe all disasters will happen. I think we need to take that bull by the horn.
It strikes me that when we talk about eradicating extreme poverty, most people tend to assume we mean the emerging world, but poverty, extreme poverty, exists not just in emerging markets but also in developed markets. From your work and your research and that of your colleagues, are there different strategies that we need to deploy if you're addressing the problem in a developed Western market or economy versus an emerging market?
Right, so I think that extreme poverty is a word that's used in many different ways, and obviously you can't really find anybody who lives under $1.90 a day in the US. That doesn't mean there's no extreme poverty. I think poverty is partly relative, and people's perception that they are cut out of the normal way of living in a country is what makes people feel extremely disempowered and angry, and you can see that that's having consequences across the board. I mean, if you know, and whoever you, I assume you know what this has meant for the political economy of America and how that feeds back on all kinds of things. And I think that particular issue, I say that because it's important to realize that it's not a matter, you could transfer 40 cents a day to a person in, Liberia and really change their lives. You couldn't do that in the US. So the resource needs to have impact on extreme poverty are very different. That's point number one, which is that you could, if you want to do it, you have to come with a fairly different sense of what the budget is. And I emphasize that because it's important to first say that I think our moral obligation at some level has to be to the world's extremely deprived, the people who live under a dollar a day. And for those people, I do feel that, we need to just think of, how little it will take to make their life better. And I think that's a fact that we should put front and center. Now, having said that, I think we know that in the US or in two countries I know well, are US and France. And to both these countries, I think the consequences of long-term deprivation of a particular social class has had enormous political consequences and has risked the entire structure of the global economy. I think these are really, this is the margin of, that's what partly drove Brexit, a bunch of people, angry people who felt that they were somehow left out of an economic boom that other people were enjoying. And I think two things are, one thing make that very different. One is that I think these people actually don't want just money. They want their dignity back. And their dignity, so the as against, I would say, in Liberia, where people are, in the first order, people don't like to starve. They don't like the children starving. They don't like the children dying of diseases that are treatable. And in that sense, resources are more important in a place like Liberia. A place like the US, you really have to think of putting meaning back into people's lives. I don't think you can just say that, we'll give you some extra money and go away and be content with that. I think what's happened in the US is lots of places, especially not on the two coasts, in between, just jobs have vanished, and especially decent jobs have vanished, jobs which people wanted. They were, as miners, mining was never a good activity. I was thrilled to see Huawei's, the exhibition on how mining could be made less ugly, but nonetheless, miners themselves were passionate about their profession. And if you read George Orwell about Road to Wigan Pier, these are people who are really in coal miners in Lancashire are passionate about coal mining in Lancashire, whatever the reason. And that gave them meaning. And if you say now you just have to become a burger flipper, in a McDonald's, that's not the same thing. It's just a different existence. And you have to take that into account, that if you just offer them money and not some way of creating meaning in their lives, it's not clear that there will be any less discontent. So I think that creates a fundamental challenge to how these rich economies are going to deal with their the poorest segments, which are often people who are just depressed because they don't have the kind of structure that a job, a meaningful job gave them. And you can see the statistics are kind of, in the US, are mind-boggling. The last 4 years, the US mortality rates among white men and women has been rising. So the life expectancy in the US is falling, first time since 1919. 1919 was the influenza epidemic. This is the first time since then mortality rates have gone up. And that's kind of, this includes the Second World War. And mortality rates didn't go up in the Second World War, they're going up now. People are committing suicide, they're dying of opioids, and they're dying of alcohol. And this is a situation where I don't think you can simply assume that, you know, putting money, a bit more money online will solve the problem. So I do feel that we need to think, therefore, of how the economy would be restructured to create more meaningful jobs for people in a situation where AI and competition from abroad are kind of taking jobs away. So this is the real core challenge of, I think, the rich economies, which is in that sense quite different from that of the poor economies, where I think basically resources will be the first step. And that's not the same thing in the US.
Professor Huang, you're a man from Beijing. You were born in Beijing. You're also an economics professor. What lessons do you think the emerging world can learn from what China has achieved over the last 30 years, specifically in terms of eradicating extreme poverty?
This is a very good question. Because now, regarding China's economic development and economic management, 在学界 东西方也好 就包括我们国内也好 都是有争议的 有争议的 但是我们从结果上来看 中国的这个模式啊 毕竟是中国 从一个贫穷的 这个 40年前 非常贫穷的一种状态 现在 去年 大概根据国家统计局的正式发布的这个 结果 大概人均的GDP已经超过了1万美元 超过了1万美元 这个是40年中 是14亿人 的人均GDP超过1万美元 这是一个很不容易取得的 很辉煌的一个成就 所以这就至少说明了一个问题 就是说 中国的这个制度 它本身有它的合理性 有它存在的合理性 那这个中国的这个模式它的特点主要在几个什么方面呢一个是开放就是它这种开放呢又不像是南美这些国家它按照这个华盛顿共识这样突然把市场放开把金融放开把货币这个放开这个把对外资的全部放开这样放开了以后他们自己的自身的这种 造血能力其实并没有提升，这样就使他们陷入了一种叫发展经济学可能叫做中等收入陷阱，中等收入陷阱就是长期处在一种中等收入的状况下，不能摆脱。当然，这个现在经济学家也在提醒中国说，中国会不会落入中等收入陷阱？那么中国这个模式呢，它的特点就是。 一个是开放，但是是有序的开放，这是一个；再一个是发展市场经济，这个让市场在资源配置中发挥决定性的作用。当然，这个我们现在还不是做得很完美了，正是在逐步完善这一点，但方向是这个方向。这样，正是因为这样的改革，才有了今天的华为。 华为就是一个在市场经济的环境下，依靠自己的努力、自己的创造性、自己的投入和积累，这样发展起来的一家企业。所以这证明这个方向是成功的。再有就是中国政府，它借助政府的力量来投资那些仅靠市场不能够解决的问题，比如基础设施的超前投入。你像中国目前的这个。 交通也好，能源也好，特别是电力供应也好，这个教育、 要与现在每年有800万大学毕业生，虽然这个教育质量还有很大的提高的余地，但是至少它在很大程度上满足了中国的这个人民他富裕起来以后对教育的这种需求啊。再有中国这个你像他这个现在开始把这个经济的这个模式开始向提高质量靠创新驱动来转型，这些都是政府的一些政治力量一些力量结合市场的一些力量在推动着整个经济的发展，所以这都值得研究，这都值得研究。有的西方说把这个说成是国家资本主义，其实中国也不是西方意义上的国家资本主义，所以我觉得应该允许每个国家选择适合自己国家的经济发展的模式，这样不要把它这个硬归类到是资本主义还是社会主义，是姓资还是姓社，对吧？我们不要去争论这些问题，而是从经济发展的角度，从人民富裕的角度，从这个社会财富分配更合理的角度，从这个人民生活的改善这个角度来客观的来看这个制度本身的它的这个优点和它的需要继续改进的地方。我觉得在这个领域里，这个Banerjee教授夫妇的这个工作啊，我特别尊重，特别引起我尊敬的一点，就是他们用科学的方法，用这种随机这个实地实验的这种方法来科学的来评价这个事情，而不是从一些经济学的定义啊，或是经济学的理论啊，或者这些某些人主观的这些带有偏见的这种意识来评价这个政策是对是不对，这个制度是对是不对，我觉得这个是非常令人尊重，非常令人尊敬的。我的个人的观点是这样。
Thank you.
And I guess there,
也谢谢你。
There are pros and cons to every approach. From your work, is there any observations that you would make from, let's say, the approach of the Chinese government versus other Western governments in terms of what works and what doesn't work in addressing poverty?
Not really. I think that's a sort of question that we have tried to avoid. I mean, I think it's better to talk about specific strategies on specific things, and I think the general philosophy, I mean, you know, even within China you can see that over time the strategies have changed, and I think what's more important, I think what makes China quite distinct is this real commitment to experimenting and, you know, to try things and abandon it. I think what's remarkable here is that, you know, we don't have, I mean, I ask, this something interests me, so I ask people, and what was striking is lots of provincial governments will try something, or even county governments will try something, and then find it didn't work, we give it up, we try something else. And the number of things that are, I think one should catalog the number of things that were given up. That's the real mensch. That's what makes China rather remarkable. It's not so much this policy or that policy, but willingness to say we didn't succeed. This one didn't work. Let's move on, do something else. I think that willingness is key. I mean, it's a willingness that most governments don't have, and they're very chary to acknowledge that that something they proposed with some hope didn't work, and you keep, you know, I am somewhat more familiar with this conversation in France or in India than in the US, but in those countries it's just very hard to get governments to acknowledge failure, and there's nothing wrong with trying and failing. I think, you know, I think the idea that we can get a cookbook out of, you know, abstract knowledge, as Professor Huang said, this is a little bit of a fantasy. I think we, in the end, we have some of, we can push our abstract knowledge to some point, and there is some value to sort of saying that this makes no sense. But once you got that past that, you have to try. There's no other way to know whether this is going to be the right strategy or not. And I mean, I don't mean try everything, but I mean, you know, you read read what's available, you figure out what the choices are. But within that, I still think there's always going to be a lot of guesswork. And I think what strikes me as being one of the key unique features of such Chinese policy is the willingness to try and fail and recognize the failure. And that I think is more important than the specificities of the policies.
And Professor Huang, we're in Shenzhen, a city that in many ways is 40 years old and was actually built on the back of mobility. Did Shenzhen's growth, I mean, Shenzhen's population now is about 23 million. Is Shenzhen's growth predicated on mobility? Have there been losers in the success of Shenzhen as a city? Any thoughts?
Yeah. 您这个问题很好。 从深圳来讲， 特别像刚才Banerjee教授说的， 这个搬家这个问题， 深圳实际上某种意义上 就是一个搬家搬出来的一个城市， 就是你看深圳它是一个移民城市， 大量的这个知识分子， 大学生， 甚至一些这个农村贫困地区的人口， 这个青壮年， 到深圳来， 最后开拓了现在的深圳。 深圳现在的GDP大概是在 北上广， 它已经超过了广州了， 已经逼近这个北京， 逼近了上海， 而且从增长率上， 它还更快。 那么这样一个城市的成功呢， 这个现在可以看出政府 正在把一个在点上的成功 变成一个区域的成功。 比如说这个 香港、澳门、这个深圳、这个广州和这个珠海，这样形成一个大的湾区的，用深圳的成功来带动这些地区的这个整体的这个增长。现在中国有几个这种大的区域性的，像长江经济带，像珠三角、长江三角洲，像这个环渤海的这些经济带，这个政府有一些大的规划。 它其实都是在从一个点上的成功逐渐扩散出来的一个区域，扩散到区域的成功，从而多个区域又带动了整个国家的成功。这些模式的发展，其实在其他国家也有，但是可能它推进的规模不像在中国似的，它是发挥市场和政府两个这个力量在推动这个 成功的经济模式走向更大的成功。我还有一个就是对这个 Banerjee教授的有一个， 就是他的这个能够获得诺贝尔奖啊，在我来看，就是选择一个正确的方向，专注在一个领域里长期的深入的研究。这是我觉得从这个方面来说和华为有点像，华为它也是， 他就是把自己的企业把客户的需求做好，他对研发人员的要求叫做板凳宁做十年冷，就是要塌下心来专心做好一件事情，做到极致啊，做到极致。那么每个人都这样做的话，或者不光是华为，甚至整个国家，如果每一个人都选择了自己的方向，这样一辈子的做下去， 做精做透，我想这个就是现在经济学家所说的， 包括AI 将来可能会造成失业，会造成什么这些问题，都是可以从根本上解决的。华为就是做好自己的事情，华为对社会的贡献呢，就是把自己的这个技术，把自己的产品，把自己的服务做好，同时给政府交税，多交税，创造就业，是吧？ 华为目前的这个发展模式呢，其实对整个中国的这个经济的转型、结构的转型，起了一个很好的示范作用，就是要走华为的路。华为的路是什么呢？就是在研发上重视长期的投入，在这个整个公司的发展中呢， 这个在短期目标和长期目标出现冲突的时候，以长期目标和企业的长期利益放在更优先的位置上。再有，华为就是专注于自己的领域，专心意义地做好一件事，这个为国家做贡献。所以这个中国华为，你比如说华为也对教育，它也是一直在呼吁国家要重视基础教育。就像这个任总也引述过，就威灵顿当时有一句名言，他说这个就是英国在这个英国的这个在这个他的胜利啊是在伊顿的板球场上这个开始的。这个像这个华为也是，任总也是从这个意义上来推动国家，呼吁国家来重视教育。但是华为并不是自己直接投资于教育，或是自己帮助穷困人某个地方，甚至任总的家乡去摆脱这个贫困，通过发展教育摆脱贫困，而是通过这种，还是通过做好自己的事情，为国家做好贡献，通过政府的力量来改善这个整个国家的这个状况。所以我觉得这个华为的这些路子，包括华为的这些战略和华为的这些管理思想，和这个Banerjee教授的他的研究的这个风格啊，都是一致的。所以Banerjee教授的成功和华为的成功，他实际上在本质上遵循的都是共同的规律，就是专注做好一件事情，方向选对，专注做好一件事情。
You know, the promise of digital technologies, of ICT, Huawei's core business, particularly in the world of 5G, is we can eradicate distance, whether you're delivering healthcare remotely, education remotely. There are now universities where their students don't physically go to class each day. Your thoughts, please, on the contribution that ICT has made to addressing the social issues that start with poverty, and any goals or ambitions that the ICT industry should have for the future.
So it's, I think in the development sector, I would say that the examples where ICT has been successful, I think also tell us a little bit about where I think it needs to go to be more successful. And I think that, so one of the places where it's clearly been successful, and one of the points we make in our book, Poor Economics, is in just providing entertainment to people. And one of the, I think we should never underestimate how important it is for somebody who has very little access to entertainment to be able to watch a YouTube video. That's actually, you know, most people, we give the example of a man in Morocco who tells us, you know, yes, I'm starving, and then it turns out he owns a big TV, and we ask him, why do you own a big TV if you're starving? He says, you know, TV is more important than food. And I think that example is very telling. It's very telling because he's telling us something important. He's saying, look, I have to survive. I have to stay sane. You can tell me that I can eat some more chickpeas. And, you know, there's only so many chickpeas I want to eat. I really want something else in my life, something that makes my life look worth looking forward to. I look forward to the football games that I can see on TV. And my friends come over and we watch football, and that's much more exciting to me than having some more chickpeas. And I think one should never underestimate, in this development conversation, we're often a little bit too prudish, and we want to say that, you know, the only good things are which make you healthier, more educated. But I think entertainment is very important, and I think providing high quality entertainment to people who really have very drab lives is extremely important. And one should never underestimate the pleasure of that. So I want to say that first, which is that I think where the greatest success has been, if you go to the small towns or villages in India, and young boys are watching Manchester United play Liverpool, and all excited about that. And you can talk to them, and they'll say, "Yes, look at that goal." This is just, I think this has changed the world in a very substantive way. And I think we should start by putting that out there, that entertainment is, access to entertainment is actually very inequitable, and that there's a lot of people with a lot of time in hand who don't have access to entertainment, and that this is valuable. You know, I think that whether it's, of course, we have to forget, we forget that there were other things that where it took its place, there were community plays, but I do think that there is a sense in which those things still were required a lot of investment, and this is easier. I think there is some value there. Let me say that. Having said that, I would say that the other places where it's been very valuable are things like, I think one place where is in digital payment structures. M-Pesa in Kenya, there's lots of evidence that M-Pesa in Kenya has been very useful for people to, you know, mitigate disasters. When you need, your child falls sick and you need money to take them to the hospital, some cousin can send you money from somewhere and does it in seconds. And that's actually extremely useful to be able to, and it's also useful to be able to just communicate to your family. I think one of the questions of why people don't migrate, well, partly don't migrate because they like staying in touch. And being able to send money back and forth and being able to call people and talk to them are valuable. The third place where it's been very useful in places is in using digital reporting structures for, you know, complaints against government officials. So that's one place where there's been a fair amount of innovation, and you know, the governments have set up portals where you can, if the street in front of your house has a pothole in it, you can report it. And there's evidence that those things work. I think that the place where the evidence is slow to come in, but I think will come in, is in education. So I think there were a bunch of attempts to do, early attempts to do kind of computer-based education. There were a few successes. We have some work on one of the early successes, but most of them didn't do very much. They created parallel structures rather than interact with the general education system. And so now I think that's changing. Now you can have live classrooms, which are, you know, active and interactive and live, but that technology, I think while that technology, 5G is going to make that much easier, I think one thing that is probably worth, and this is where it comes to where I think that and, for example, microsurgery done at long distance, I think both of those cases, I think one place where I think Huawei can, I think, contribute a lot to welfare is by thinking harder about what's the binding constraint, what is it that makes it hard to do. And then anytime you try to do one of these things on the ground, you realize that there are many things that go wrong. It's just dirty. There's no space within which the technology can operate, and if you can't, there's no space where you can operate, then of course it quickly stops working. So, you know, just I think there's a whole kind of a supply chain of things that have to be taken care of before, for example, microsurgery can be done in a village in the Sahel. Just there's just too many things that are missing. Just space, clean space, ways to kind of people whose job is to keep the space clean, somebody with enough training to use the technology. So there's a bunch of stuff that kind of gets in the way. And I think where I think it's useful to think about for a company like Huawei, which is very conscious of its social role. I mean, you hear a lot about, you know, how this is going to be, and less, you know, using less energy, and so there's a clear awareness of the social contribution of the company. A company like that, I think it's very important to try to think of what are places where maybe the technology has to be tweaked to be usable in the most dire conditions. That's to me is where I think a lot of these things have failed. Is that, you know, the latency has gone down, and so you can see a video, but you know, in the dust, the screen looks really not very attractive, and you can't see very much, and the screen quality is still pretty low. And I think so. You have to kind of think about the entire ecosystem that will use these technologies, and even more true of surgical procedures done long distance. There's too many things that go wrong. So I think it would be, and I think there your understanding of what is possible is so much deeper than that of everybody else. So in that sense, I do feel that there is a place for a company like Huawei to say, look, we're going to do an end-to-end solution to this problem. We're going to deliver whatever education or healthcare or whatever other thing in Niger. And that's an interesting challenge to take up, because it's not a challenge that anybody takes up. Everybody says, okay, we are developing the technology and that's great, and now it can be used in Niger. But those are two separate statements. It's actually, to use it in Niger, you have to solve a bunch of the last mile problems. I think I think if the technology was designed with the last mile in mind, you might actually get more value from that. So I think my one thought is that, which is that I do think that sometimes, in my experience, trying to work with, you know, schools that use computer assisted learning, or children using tablets in villages to learn, it seems to me that the sort of the physical constraints on that start to bind all too often, and having somebody who really understands the possibilities of the technology, what can I fix easily, rather than build the best technology and let the world take care of it. I think thinking about the end-to-end product, I think that would be valuable. I think to my mind, that's one place where I would love to see more, and I would love to, you know, participate in those conversations. I have, after all, a little bit of an advantage in terms of having been there and knowing what happens and what goes wrong.
We do have a program called Tech for All, which is designed to address some of these issues, and maybe we can get you programs. I think we've talked among ourselves for long enough. I'd like to hear from the audience and your questions. So to ask a question, all you got to do is raise your hand. I'll try and take them in the order that I see them. So I'm going to come to you, sir, first. And
Professor Banerjee, this question follows on from a lot of what's already been discussed. But I'm old enough to remember the early days of globalization and economic discussions on that in the 1990s, and I wanted to say a lot of the research that I'm reading, a lot of the discussion about artificial intelligence feels very similar, that in aggregate, the economy, society will benefit. There will be losers, but there'll be mostly winners. I wonder if you hold with that tenet, and if so, what should we be doing now to mitigate the worst impacts of artificial intelligence, and do you advocate policies such as a universal basic income, for example?
So I would say that, like with trade, I suspect what will happen is that there will be three important changes. One is that there will be many of us will win a little, and a few people will lose a lot. And the people who win a little are never going to be the advocates of supporting it. The people who lose a lot are going to be the upset people. So that's first thing to worry about. That's what happened with globalization as well. And we should anticipate that. We should anticipate that this is what's going to happen. It's going to be, losing will be more concentrated than the winning. The winning will come in productivity gains here and there. We'll all be, you know, we'll get cheaper cars or, you know, better surgery. And the losers will lose their job and their livelihood. and they're going to be much more upset, and that's the political dynamic that we're dealing with. So that's point number one. Second point is that I think in particular the tax treatment of AI seems to me to be biased in too much in favor of AI. I say this in Huawei, where maybe you won't approve of this, but it's true that if you think of just the fact that if a worker is fired and has no livelihood, society actually has to bail him out. He has to feed him, okay? He has to give him a living. So in other words, the social cost of losing a worker is substantial always, because we will eventually have to pay for him. Capital has no comparable cost. So therefore, the relative cost of losing a worker is underestimated by the private entrepreneurs. So that's first thing to emphasize. Second thing is that in fact, these days, depreciation is treated, you know, when you fire a worker, when you hire a worker, you don't get any accelerated depreciation on it. Whereas the entire structure of depreciation favors capital. So through the tax system, we actually favor using more capital and in a distorting way. So I think that's very important that we need to, before we come to universal basic income, I think we need to just fix the tax distortions that are actually in favor of using too much AI. In particular, my colleague Darren Acemoglu has argued that there's a lot of adoption of so-so AI, not so much AI that's actually increasing a lot of productivity. In fact, AI can reduce productivity and you still adopt it because the tax treatment is so favorable. So I think that that's a general distortion that needs to be fixed. Third thing I want to say is that I think that there's a sense in which people have this idea that they're going to somehow, like I think the EU has a proposal to actually try to tax AI. I think that's unrealistic. I don't think you can directly tax AI, because I think AI is going to be embedded in machines. It's not going to be called AI separately. So I don't think that's a realistic proposal. I think I think taxing capital in general is, or evening the taxation of labor and capital, I think that's a fair thing to try. I don't think we can actually do very much about taxing AI. That's my guess. Maybe I'm wrong, but my sense is that, you know, this, you can change the label and turn it into something else, and it's going to be hard to do. That said, I would say universal basic income, we have in our book, we have a long discussion of that, and goes back to some, I think I said before, which is that I think people don't just want income, they want dignity. And universal basic income doesn't give you dignity. So I really think we are in a place where we need to think deeper about this question.
And Professor Huang, mm-hmm. any thoughts on AI and the challenges and the opportunities as it applies to this discussion?
我个人的看法是这样，就任何一个先进的技术，它可能对传统的产业或传统的社会运行方式、社会结构造成问题，但它同时也是解决问题的手段。就任何一个先进的技术，即使造成问题，也是解决问题的一种方式和手段。你比如工业革命的时候，当时有这个卢德运动嘛，就是因为这个纺织机的普及，这个纺织工人失业了，那么他用杂碎纺织机的方式来抵制这种社会或者技术的进步。但事实证明，这些纺织原来的纺织工人，他可以转到其他的领域，可以转到机器带来的其他的产业上去。 这个包括汽车的普及，那马车夫肯定也要失业，但是马车夫也可以是去做别的事情，因为汽车它带动了整个经济的繁荣，它的交通的方便，人们这个生活方式、生活的这个范围的扩展，以及是汽车它带来的这整个工业体系的这个发展，还是创造了许多机会。所以我对 AI 我基本上是乐观的，就是一个提高生产率的这个方式。 它从长期来看，它一定是创造就业的方式，同时也是改善人们生活的方式。
比如说如果真是生产率非常高了，那么我们 一周不一定非要工作五天四十个小时，是不是可以工作四天，是吧？四六二十四个小时，是吧？这都有可能的，这都有可能的。这样人们有更多的闲暇呢，可以有更多的时间去发展自己的个性，去学习，去提高自己的能力，去适应这个新的社会的需求。所以我对 AR 的看法，我还是抱着积极的态度，还是这个对技术进步我还是看好的。再一个就是这个华为做的事情啊，实际上用这个俗话来说叫授人以鱼还是授人以渔，这两个在中文的发音是一样的，字的含义是不一样的。授人以鱼嘛，就是我给你一条鱼，我给你补助，我给你这个财政上的这个支持，是吧？但是这个是很容易，鱼可以被吃掉，这个财政补助可以被花掉，是吧？它是不是一种可持续性的。授人以鱼呢，那个鱼在中文的是三点水，那个鱼它就包括了捕鱼，包括了钓鱼，包括了养鱼，其实就是它就是一个给你提高技能，给你提高生存能力的一种方式。那么中国有这种古话，其实它里边蕴含的意义对未来也是有指导意义的，就是我们要帮助人们，就华为的这个做法就是通过这个改善通信，改善 IT 的这些基础设施，改善这个它的接入手段和它的应用手段，这样授人以鱼，就是这个有三点水的那个鱼，就是提高人们的能力，提高人们适应社会，这个也是提高人们自身的这种发展的这种能力。华为主要是在这个方面做贡献。我整体上来说，我是对技术进步持乐观的态度。
And that, ladies and gentlemen, is all the time we have. Thank you for your questions. Thanks for coming along. Please join me in thanking our two speakers today, Professor Huang Weiwei, Renmin University Beijing, and Nobel Prize winning Professor Banerjee from MIT in Boston.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.